On April 11th, 2019, Dr. Czar took a group of students taking his course on the supernatural and Western history to the Cleveland Museum of Art to examine some examples of the supernatural in art.
Economics department for Dr. Samantha Hai, and I interned here at the Cleveland Museum of Art. I started my internship here in 2018 in the summer with the curator for the museum, Dr. Sonia Mace, who actually just came to the school today to speak about the history of the museum. So I started my internship with her, and really she just taught me the rules about what to know as a curator, and she taught me how to understand the art, how to interpret the art. So it was really beneficial in that way, where I get to understand more about Asian art. So my area of study is really in Chinese art, but it really helped me to understand the history of Buddhism and Indian art. So that's just where my internship helped. And then here at the museum, I continued on to do the new tour guide fellowship that I'm doing now. This is a brand new program that they just started this year, where you can sign up to be a tour guide. You can give at least 8 tours a semester, primarily in the spring semester. In the fall, they train you, and then in the spring, you give your tours. So it's not intimidating at all. They teach you the ropes of how to give tours in the museums like these. And yeah, it's really just the gist of it. It's still a new program. They want to recruit more John Carroll students. So if you guys are interested, let me know, because most of the students participating now are Case Western and CSU. So and they would love to have you with you guys come and intern if you're interested. So yeah, that's really just the gist of my introduction about the museum. But today, since this is a supernatural course, as far as I understand, we're going to be going through this atrium, by the way. This is the brand new installation within the museum. And then we're going to go through the museum. So we're just going to be exploring part of the supernatural, understanding the concepts of supernatural in ancient times up to the 17th century in Italy. That's where we're going to end our tour. So, that being said, follow me.
A region called Western Antonia, which is modern day Turkey right now. So then, this piece is actually one of the oldest anthropomorphic or human figurine sculptures in the museum. The figure depicts a female. It may not look like it at appearance, but yeah, it's a female. And the way you can tell is that it has this kind of elegant figurine where it kind of looks like she has curves a little bit. So it's really interesting there. So these curves in a way are related to fertility and life-giving qualities. And then the context of the figure is really unknown. So we don't know the purpose of it. We don't know why it was made. We don't even know who made it. So it's really interesting how a lot of these prehistoric pieces kind of appear. And then it's one of 30 similar figures that were excavated in Turkey. So this is a very rare figure. This is one of the few museums that has it. So then, why do you think, I guess I'm going to ask you guys, why do you think it's called the Star Gazer? Yes, actually, because, and that's what a lot of scholars have said, that the nose is pointed upward and the face, we put it upward.
So does that point to some religious, religious significance, probably?
So yeah, I was going to, that's
okay.
The next
thing.
I was, no, you're fine. That was the next thing I was going to address. The fact that it is pointed upward, scholars have kind of inferred it to be like a religious connotation to the piece. So since we don't know the purpose of this piece and why they were made, some scholars think that it may be a deity. It may just be a religious illusion. It may just be a figurine. I'm not taking the course. How does this piece relate to the context of your course?
Well, like, we just did creative projects, and a few of us did like astrology, or like zodiac signs. So since this is the stargazer, and she's looking up, it kind of just reminds me of like the supernatural phenomenon of maybe like the zodiac signs or astrology in general.
I'm kind of curious myself. Those of you who did the astrology presentations, are any of you actually stargazers, or do you just read about? Oh, you are. Okay.
I'm here, Julia.
Okay. Anybody else?
Yeah. Any other ways?
And we looked at ancient belief systems, so that's part of the interest in it as well. We started the course by looking at sort of the origins of beliefs in supernatural things.
Yeah, we read some ancient Mesopotamian material, Gilgamesh, and we read some excerpts from the Hebrew Bible.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
So yeah, with this piece, since it was so long ago, it was prehistoric, we don't know their religious practice. We don't know the religious practice. And then, yeah, like I said, it does have a divine attribute. Are there any other questions about the PC table? Because that was all I had on this piece. Or comments?
Can we all take a closer look?
Yeah, oh,
yeah, that's a good idea.
It's more realistic looking.
It's okay, I can answer it. So, it's okay, don't worry. Both the Stargazer and this piece are female figurines. So the Stargazer would have been in the form of a female from her curves. And then just like and they have this presumed divine element. Well, the star gaze are more, it's only is presumed, but with Aphrodite, it's a definite divine element as she's a goddess. So it kind of just ties in. It's interesting how these two pieces tie in gender with the supernatural, the idea of supernatural, with the underlying idea of fertility.
But yes, this one is much more realistic. An individual one.
Right.
And she has a face. She has facial features.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, meanwhile, with the Stargazer, you don't really see the face. It's just a figure. It's just like a figurine. You don't really know. So then just some other little details before we move on to the next piece. Some details that I really liked when I was researching this. This work was likely inspired by Aphrodite of Nios. This was a work created by Praxiteles, an ancient Greek scholar during the 4th century, around the same time that this piece was made. So that's another thing about this piece, we don't know who made it. But it was inspired by another piece during that time. So the piece that I'm talking about by Praxiteles, unlike the Aphrodite, this Aphrodite sculpture, that one would have been life-size, so it probably would have been about our height. And it's also a nude image of Aphrodite. But some scholars have said about that piece that the nudity represents a conception to, it's like an alternate to the conception of the heroic nudity for male sculptures. So it may carry that same significance here. We aren't quite sure.
So you mean it's meant to represent or be?
It's an alternate to like nude sculptures of male figurines in ancient Greek art. Any other questions or comments about the piece? I guess, and I should have asked as well, have you guys learned about Greek gods and goddesses in your course?
Yeah.
What can you tell me about what you learned in the course?
Okay, so we pretty much learned that there's a god and goddess for everything. Zeus is kind of the head god, and then there's Aphrodite, you know, Poseidon, Hades, you know, we just learned about all the gods and like, their roles.
Amusement, really. So then these four images exhibited here are Rose's method of exploiting these ideas of witchcraft in such a unique, novel way. So then I'm just going to talk a little bit. There's a lot going on in these pictures, so I'm just going to talk a little bit about each and then leave it open for questions and discussion. So for the morning scene, you have this young enchantress here. It looks like she has a sword and is sticking it in a frog's mouth. So it's a little, it's pretty grotesque. It's pretty grotesque how she's treating the animal. So really you just see the supernatural. You don't really see too much of the supernatural element with this enchantress. I mean, I know I'm calling her an enchantress. It just looks like a woman sticking the sword in this enlarged frog. But just the enlarged animals around her kind of emphasize the supernatural. And then along with that, this, I know it's supposed to be depicting morning, but the morning looks pretty gloomy. Yeah, it looks very, very gloomy morning that this is illustrated. So then over here in the daytime, you have much older witches. They're called hags. I have pretty strong feelings against that term, but that's what they're called for these images. So these older witches are holding brooms. Some of them are holding the broom. Some of them are holding skulls, and they're cutting open some type of reptile. Looks like a lizard. Yeah, that's a lizard. So then something interesting that Rosa does here is that witches usually ride goats, but he replaced the goat for an owl. So, yeah, that's an owl he replaced it with. So it's quite interesting how he did that. So then what's also funny, well, not really, it's not funny that you're cutting open a lizard, but what's the comedic attribute to this image, or the comedic iconography that you see, is that they're really just doing these grotesque things, like holding these human skulls and cutting open animals during the day. I mean, you could imagine somebody doing something criminal like that at night, but they're like in broad daylight cutting these, cutting animals open and just doing all of these really grotesque things. And in the evening, you have older witches here. Here, I'm just going to try to move out a little bit for you guys. So yeah, older witches, but they're around a cauldron and they're kind of working up some concoctions, some spells. And then above them, it may be hard to see back there, but there's a skull. Looks like it's not exactly a human skull either. It's a skull of some other type of supernatural creature. He is holding an hourglass, which is a representation or an alliteration of the brevity of life, that we only have a short time on this planet. And then the A is interesting. When I was doing a little bit of research on what the A represents, some scholars were inferring that it's a symbol of judgment. I don't know much about the A. That's really all I can think about. But, I mean, the judgment can also represent this other supernatural element along with this piece. So you have this skull that's standing over them, but the A, this judgment, where is it coming from? You know, there could be like another higher being that's judging and these witches. So this part of the image is really supernatural in that part. And then, night. So then at night, I'm going to stay in this place a little bit. You have these groups of men out at night. And then you have this one, he kind of stands out from the rest of the men. These two men are kind of on their knees next to this older man. So the older man is supposed to be a sorcerer. And he is kind of standing headstrong against this creature. We don't know what this creature is. So Rosa here really just emphasizes the supernatural element, where you have this sorcerer standing against this really weird creature, and then you have these other men kind of standing around watching him, like, whoa, what's going on? represents Rosa's extravagance, like in his pieces, like how he is unafraid to depict images of witches and sorcerers. You know, and it was very unique at the time. Yeah, that was really all I had about these pieces. Well, my question was more, do you think Rose's portrayals of witches here place witchcraft in a good or bad way? Like, how is he depicting witchcraft in a good or bad way? I know I emphasized on the grotesqueness, but I just want your opinion. I just want your opinion.
I feel like the image in the day for the nighttime, the evening, with the A and the red, I feel like that kind of is like the devil. In a sense, like, controlling them, because the witchcraft is like next to the devil and all that. So I don't think that's very possible either. When
right.
The tree's on fire.
Yeah, it just really poses that question, who's doing the judgment and who's in the devil?
And like we just watched a movie called The Witch, so like these pictures, like for like especially the last two, remind me of like the ending scene where the girl becomes a witch, and that just kind of makes me like more convinced it's portrayed in a bad way.
Mm-hmm. It's like that at the end of the woods.
So who would say like would any of you say positive, or are we all thinking negative? Believe it or not, some people would say positive because of the idea that he is portraying witches in such a time where, you know, it wasn't popular.
Yeah. It's interesting too, like, we just learned about, like, witches and their characteristics, and a lot of times animals are present while they're performing, like, their spells or rituals. So this is like, what was this?
17th century. They just had like a range of bears.
Okay.
And they weren't
so just like the historical aspects. It's interesting.
Right. So then, why? Well, other than that reason for the animals, why else do you think Rose is using animals in these images? What's another reason? So what I think, which is really interesting, what I think is that the witches and, yeah, especially the witches, how they're treating animals in these two images in particular, I think they represent humans, they represent humanity, and what Rosa could be doing, and some scholars infer this too, is kind of parodying grotesqueness against animals, like whether it's in the action of hunting or just animal rule, any form of animal cruelty in general, and how humans in a sense can be grotesque against animals. Even in, you know, even in the form of just eating like a cheeseburger or something, you know?
Do we know why he painted these? Were they for a patron or an occasion?
I actually didn't find that. I tried to find that. We can assume it was, because a lot of painters at the time did paint for wealthy patrons.
But it makes you wonder what, if he did paint it for a patron or an occasion.
Yeah, what was this, who was this person he was painting
was
for?
Was it a warning against witchcraft, or was it for someone who was
interested
in witchcraft?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
A witch.
Or also a well-to-do witch.
The picture is literally like the end of the witch
movie.
Yeah.
When they're like
screaming
in a circle.
Yeah,
and
they're
talking
about
the
baby.
Yeah,
is it so? Oh, you know, what do you think? I guess now that we're on, just real quick, last ending question. What do you think of the fact that he's portraying women and then he ends with the sorcerer?
You know?
I think it's interesting on the first painting, the way he painted the woman in such bright contrast to the background.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it's kind of ironic in a religious aspect, because, you know, like, angels, all everything really seems to be bright and everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then it slowly moves through the progression to the end, and like the only thing that's bright at the end is the fire.
It's very nice.
Yeah. Yeah, and the fact that she's this young sorceress in who's portrayed in the morning, which is kind of a double entendre of the early, like the early young witch in such an early period. And kind of the origins of these witchcraft novels during the Renaissance. But yeah, I don't know what to think of. I honestly don't know what to think of the fact that he ended with a man, a male sorcerer. I think that's really interesting. Are there any more questions or comments on this?
As a question for my students, which work of art did you find most interesting on our trip? Please let me know in the comments section below this video.
If you like this video and would like to receive notification of new videos, please feel welcome to subscribe to History and Headlines and become one of our patrons. Your viewership is much appreciated.